My God is more than enough. He can supply all my needs. He is my El Shaddai. He always looks out for me. Jehovah Jireh. He is my God. All of the earth is His, and the fullness thereof. Everything that you need, you can be sure of. Jehovah Jireh, He is my God. Oh, oh, oh. So why should I worry about the highs and the lows, the ups and the downs, when by my faith I know my God is more than enough. He can supply all my needs. He is my El Shaddai. He always looks out for me. Jehovah Jireh, He is my God. All of the earth is His, and the fullness thereof. Everything that you need, you can be sure of. Jehovah Jireh, He is my God. Oh, oh, oh. So why should I worry about the highs and the lows, the ups and the downs, when by my faith I know my God is more than enough. He can supply all my needs. He is my El Shaddai. He always looks out for me. Jehovah Jireh, He is my God. Oh, Jehovah Jireh, He is my God.
I want to encourage you on that. We'll have the information on the website and on the app there. Next Sunday service registration opens up tomorrow, so make sure you go ahead and go online and do that. And we are having some meetings this week where we're starting to plan on what we're going to do when school goes back, because, you know, school starts back here in a couple Wednesdays, and we're planning on doing some things. I'm meeting with the board Wednesday night, talk about that, so expanding our offerings for the fall, where we can start doing some classes again. I'm really excited about that. I know this is a super challenging season for everybody, and we want to obviously offer the most that we can as a church, and so we're going to be doing that. So that's coming. So we will let you know more about that as we get closer. Now, you guys have your packets on your tables. You know the drill, but make sure when you leave today that you carry those packets with you. And if you've got an offering, you can just leave it on the table or all those things. So anyway, all right, well, let's stand back up. We're going to continue worship this morning. Let's enter into God's presence.
Father, I see that you are drawing a line in the sand, and I want to be standing on your side, holding your hand. So let your kingdom come, let it live in me. This is my prayer, this is my plea. Father, I see that you are drawing a line in the sand, and I want to be standing on your side, holding your hand. So let your kingdom come, let it live in me. This is my prayer, this is my plea. Let the worshipers arise. Let the sons and the daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all. I surrender to the King. Father, I hear and grow louder the song of your redeemed, as the saints of every nation are awakening to sing. From our hearts there comes an anthem. Oh, hear the heavens ring. This is our song, oh, a song to our King. Let the sons and the daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all. I surrender to the King. Let the worshipers arise. Let the worshipers arise. Let the sons and the daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all. I surrender to the King. Just the voices sing out. Let the worshipers arise. Let the worshipers arise. Let the sons and the daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all. I surrender to the King. Just praise Him this morning. Walking around these walls, and I thought by now they'd fall. For You have never failed me yet. And waiting for change to come, and knowing the battle's won. For You have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is Your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in Your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet. And I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing Your praise again. Jesus, You're still enough. Keep me within Your love. Oh, my heart will sing Your praise again. Your promise still stands. Great is Your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in Your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. I've seen you move the mountains, and I believe I'll see You do it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe I'll see You do it again. I've seen you move the mountains, and I believe I'll see You do it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe I'll see You do it again. I've seen You move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way. And I believe I'll see you do it again. I'll see you do it again. I'll see you do it again. Your promise still stands. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. Just give him some praise this morning. Oh, and I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know that we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Lord, you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect, Lord. You are perfect in all of your ways. I know you're perfect in all of your ways. For you are perfect in all of your ways to us. It is love so undeniable. I can hardly speak when peace so unexplainable. I, Lord, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still in love. Love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us, you're perfect. Oh, you are perfect in all of your ways. Lord, you are perfect in all of your ways. Oh, you are perfect in all of your ways. To us. Just give them some praise this morning. Just love on them.
Technology. We are not the two savviest people. Anybody on Wednesday Night Live this week? Did we not mess that up or what? We were here. We were in two different rooms just so we didn't spread the Rona. And neither one of us could figure out how to use Facebook. So between the two of us, there's not even a half of an IT person there. So I brought this because the last few weeks have been cutting into my trout fishing. And since Chris decided to come back, come out of hiding, I thought I'd just get my net out, get ready. Now, I use a saltwater net for trout fishing because the trout are so big, just a regular net doesn't work. Actually, the story behind this is I had a regular, you knew I was going to do this, didn't you? I had a regular trout net that I've used for 25 years, and I have never really missed a trout. But because I had the pastor out fishing with me, he would catch one and he'd go, "Don't lose my fish, don't lose my fish." So he went out and bought this so that I'd just absolutely make sure that I did not lose his 12-inch trout. So there we go. Just to reiterate a couple of announcements again, the Zoom class for men will be this Tuesday night, so don't miss that. If you don't know how to use that, it's pretty simple to use. You can call the church or you can go on and it'll give you instructions on how to do that. Our offering this morning, you can leave your offering on the table and the staff will pick it up, the volunteers. You can go online and do it at the website. You can do your giving on there. It's a safe way to do it. You can text it. I've never tried that. You can mail it. I haven't tried that. I do use the app. I got the app down. Now, when you use the app, just to let you know, if you give on the app, I did mine this morning before church, it's going to send you a text with a code to make absolutely sure you are who you are. So it's like one other extra step in there just so we can keep you safe and we know that nobody's going to be able to hack in there. So it has to validate who you are. So let's pray over our giving. God's been so kind to us, and you've been generous as we've gone through this last several weeks with our pastor out and so on. Giving has stayed there because we're all in this together, and we're glad to have you back regardless that you can't fish, but I'm going to work on that. I'm still working on his fishing. I have to bait the hook, cast the line. He catches it. I take it off the hook and put it in the live well. We call it fishing for seniors. That's what we call it. Let's pray together. Father, we just thank you. You're such a great God. You are a good, good Father. We love you with all our hearts. And that's why we give, Lord. We don't give out of compulsion. We don't give because we feel bad. We don't give, Lord, out of feeling of condemnation. We give to our church because we love you. And we love the ministries of our church. We love our pastors. And we thank you for that. Thank you for getting them back healthy and back to us. We pray over this message this morning, Father, that you'll just bring your anointing into this place, that we'll know that when we leave this building, we have been with you, and we have been in your presence. And everyone said, amen and amen. God bless you this morning.
Much. Thanks, Doc. So good to be back with you guys. It's so good. This is the most people I've seen in like a month. You guys are awesome. You look great. And I want to thank you guys so much for those of you that have been praying for us. We know you have. Many of y'all have dropped things by and flowers and food and all that. And I would like to go ahead and say I've not lost any weight. So thank you. That's been awesome. This was not fun going through this, but I have a deeper compassion and appreciation for those that are dealing with the challenges that come along with this, Trish and I both. And while we recognize it's real, we are also not going to be ruled by fear. And so as a church and as a community, we're going to continue to do, we're going to go by the rules, we're going to take care of ourselves, but we're not going to stop living, guys. We're not going to stop living, amen? So we're going to use wisdom and move forward. I have a request that I want to make of all of you guys. Here in the next few weeks, our students are going to go back to school. And there has been no greater area of challenge in my mind as we prepare for our community, for our most precious resource, our kids, as they're going to go back into those schoolrooms. And the teachers, the many teachers, administrators that we have here at the church and online in our church community, they need our prayers. This is a challenging time for them. The rules change constantly. They've got to have contingency plans for everything. And we need to continually lift them up in prayer, both the teachers, the students, and the administrators. So I want to do that as a church right now. Would you just join me in prayer? Let's just pray for them. Father, we thank you for our schools. We thank you for our children. We thank you for our teachers and our administrators. Father, during this challenging time, we ask you, Lord, to give them wisdom. We pray, Father, that you would give them protection. Lord, we ask you in Jesus' name that you would give them strength. Father, that they would know precisely exactly what to do. And Lord, we pray for your grace and your mercy to go before them. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. So be it. So be it. If you've got your Bibles, lift them up this morning and repeat after me, whether you're here or online. Folks, we got people watching us from Florida, Texas, Kansas, all kinds of places. Yankees are watching us. That's amazing. I don't even know how they understand. Sorry, Sue. But we're just glad all the folks online that are participating as well. Just lift up your Bibles, repeat after me. Say, this is my Bible. Every word in it is true. I am who it says I am. I can do what it says I can do. Today, I'll be taught God's word. It's his truth, transforming every part of my life. And I'll never be the same. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, I mentioned earlier, we'll be visiting with you guys over the next online and over the next Sundays about how we're going to proceed into the fall as a church. I'm excited as we move into this new season. And I want to just say up front, last night we had Keith and Barbie and Crystal and Aaron came up and they decorated outside. We had about 40 to 50 kids and families up here last night having snow cones and talking about Jesus. And just so excited to have our ministries that are still doing. We are pushing the most that we can with what we can. And we've just got a great staff and a great volunteer team. Let's give them a big hand so much for keeping things happening. You guys are just amazing. Well, I wanted to do a one-off message today, and this is the title of it. How do we get a handle on things? How do we get a handle on things? And I was thinking about so many of us. How many of you, if you look back to January, which seems like about 5 years ago, but if you look back in January, how many of you said at the beginning of the year, this year, 2020, man, I'm setting some great goals this year in 2020. I'm going to draw closer to God. Come on, somebody. How many of you said, I'm drawing closer to God? This year, 2020, Clint's going to be a year of clarity for me. I'm going to lose some weight this year. I'm going to grow closer to Jesus. How many of you made some resolutions? Can I see your hands? Oh, the honest, I blame you guys for all this stuff we're dealing with right now. This is totally your fault. Because here's what I was thinking about. Here's today's big thought. We want to grow. We want to become better, Mark. We want to become all these things that we want God to make us. But there's a challenge that goes along with that. And here's on your notes today. Here's the first big thought. I want to be changed, Andy. I want to be changed, but I don't want to be challenged. Come on, somebody. I want to be changed, but I don't want to be challenged. I want to lose 30 pounds, Dwight, but I don't want to do the work. I want to become closer to God, but I don't want to do what is necessary to draw closer to God. So here's what happens to us, guys. We begin to pray and say, hey, God, help me. I want to draw closer to you, right? But then we don't like the process that God takes us through to get us there because it's challenging. And I think this season, probably more than any one thing, Grant, more than any one thing, I've noticed that. I pray for God to do things, but then when he begins to bring them around, Monica, when he begins to do the things I prayed for, I don't like the way he's doing it, right? It's like, Jesus, I want to draw close to you. And he says, okay, then you need to walk through the valley of the shadow of death. And I'm like, is that on the brochure? Because that's not, I just want to be close to you, Jesus. I don't want to have to go through some stuff to get there. And as I have, guys, I'm just going to tell you, the last not just couple weeks of isolation, which by the way, when you're a people person, it's hard enough for me to not run out there right now and hug Charles, okay? This is hard enough for me, us having to do this. But then when you say stay home for 14 days, I thought I was going to lose my mind. You know, I'm waving at buzzards flying around. I mean, I'm just anything that's deer out in the yard. I'm kind of, can I give you a hug? You know, they're like, no, you got the Rona, man. I'm out, you know. And it's just been this challenging time. So what I learned, Barbie, during this season is I really, every day I was getting up at dark 30 in the morning and I would go sit outside and I would pray. I would pray and I would read and I would research. And I can tell you during this season, again, not just the last couple of weeks, but the last few months, I have prayed more. I have studied more. I have cried more. I have mourned this season and the changes that we are going through as a community and as a country. And I have researched and I've asked questions probably more in the last few months than I have in my whole life. Because the truth is, for most of us, we just live. We get up in the morning, we do our thing and go day to day. And then in the midst of our world, in the midst of 2020, we now begin to deal with these challenges. And I want to tell you one of the things that the Lord has taught me during this season more than any one single thing. Crisis causes innovation. You can write that down. Crisis causes innovation. When we are faced with challenges that we cannot overcome, when we run up against things that we've never dealt with before, we have to make some transitions in our life. We, in other words, we have to do things differently. If we want to succeed as individuals, if we want to succeed as a church, if you want to succeed as a family, if you want to succeed as a business, if you want to succeed as a teacher, you're having to rethink. And this crisis is causing us innovation. And I want to tell you something. I believe this with all of my heart. When God wants to bring about transformation in our lives, he typically uses a crisis. Think about all the Bible stories, Dennis, that you and I have talked about over the years and read. Think about all the miracles that you've seen happen. The reason that a miracle happened is that something was wrong. Someone was blind, and now they need to see, and so God does a miracle. An army is coming down on the children of the Hebrew children, and so God has to part the Red Sea. There's a reason, there's a crisis that causes a transformation, that causes a miracle. But you and I have a part to play in that, and that's what today's message is about. We have got to get a handle on this. We've got to get a handle on this. In a couple of weeks, the biggest activity in our community is going to start when these kids go back to school. And it's going to cause ripple effects and a transformation. There are going to be challenges in our community that we're going to have to deal with. Things that are unseen and things that are unseen. And I want to go ahead and say this to you right now. I don't think this is going to be over with quick. I would like to say this is going to be over with in a month. But I think we're going to have to deal with this for a little while. And we need to settle in our mind. God, I'm going to believe you're going to take care of it next week. But I'm going to recognize and plan for the fact that it may go on longer than that. And I'm going to settle in my heart that I'm going to trust you no matter what it takes. As a church, as a family, as a community. God, do your work, because I am listening. Amen? All right, so let's look at some scripture here today. Mark chapter 8, verses 14 through 21. Now listen, guys, some of y'all may not remember this, but Jesus actually fed two crowds on two separate occasions of big crowds. We talk about the loaves and the fishes, the little boy with the Happy Meal. Y'all remember that story? It wasn't a Happy Meal, but you know what I'm saying. He came up and loaves and the fishes, and Jesus multiplied that out. And the Bible tells us there were 5,000 men there that day. Theologians tell us there could have been, with women and children, could have been anywhere from 10 to 15,000 people. Jesus took that little boy's Happy Meal, multiplied it out, fed thousands of people. But he also did a miracle a second time where he fed a crowd where there was 4,000 men, women and plus women and children. So anywhere 8, 10, 12,000 people. Twice Jesus did a miracle where he fed thousands of people with very little. And so he's just done this the second time in Mark chapter 8. And as Jesus is getting ready to leave, he's about to get on a boat. As he's getting ready to leave, some of the Pharisees come up and start messing with him like they always did, testing him. And then Jesus has a conversation with them, and then he gets on the boat. And that's where we're going to pick up our scripture today. The disciples are on the boat. They're about to go across to another place. And look at verse 14. The disciples had forgotten to bring bread, except for one loaf that they had with them in the boat. Now, here's the deal. You know how it went. How many of you have ever been on a family vacation? Can I see your hands? Does everybody have a job? Everybody has a job. You load up, you bring this, you do that, blah, 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 right? And so somebody said to somebody, don't forget the Subway sandwiches, right? Because they've just done this miracle and had all this left over, and they get on the boat, and they look around and go, hey, what's the in-flight meal today? And somebody looked back and goes, dude, I just brought one loaf of bread, right? So that's what happened. Jesus hears them talking about this. Look at verse 15. This is what Jesus says. Be careful, Jesus warned. Watch out for the yeast of the Pharisees and that of Herod. And I'm going to talk about what that is here in a minute. They discussed this with one another. They heard Jesus say that. They discussed this with one another and said, it is because we have no bread. It is because. Do y'all know how many times the disciples misunderstood what Jesus was doing? This was a constant thing. So Jesus is having this conversation, and he gets on the boat, and he's thinking about his conversation he just said with the Pharisees. And he gets on there. The guys are going, dude, break out the meal. All I've got is one loaf of bread. And Jesus turns around and says, beware of the yeast of the Pharisees and of Herod. And the disciples go, Jesus is upset because you forgot the Subway sandwiches, which is not what's going on here at all. Aware of their discussion, verse 17, Jesus asked them, why are you talking about having no bread? Do you still not see or understand? Are your hearts hardened? Do you have eyes but fail to see, and ears but fail to hear? And don't you remember? That's very important. Circle that on your notes. And don't you remember. Remember what? When I broke the five loaves for the 5,000, and how many basketfuls of pieces did you pick up? 12, they replied. And when I broke the seven loaves for the 4,000, how many basketfuls of pieces did you pick up? And they answered, seven. And Jesus said to them, do you still not understand? Do you still not understand? And when I read this, I put myself in the boat, and my answer to Jesus was, I have no idea what you're talking about, Jesus. Here's what I want you to get today. There are two things going on in our world right now. There's the spiritual stuff that's happening, and there's the manifestation in the physical that's happening. Where do we live? Come on, somebody. Where do we live? We live in the physical side of things. So we see everything through that lens. That's how we view things, Clint. But Jesus is over here dealing with the spiritual implications of everything that's going on. And he's trying to help them connect the dots. And today, he's trying to help you and I connect the dots too. How do we get a handle on what is going on? Well, look back at your notes. Here's the first thing I want to just, this is just an aside, but I want you to understand what Jesus was talking about here. What is the yeast of the Pharisees and of Herod? A lot of times you'll hear Jesus talking about the Pharisees and the Sadducees, but in this situation, he says, what is the yeast? He says, beware of the yeast between the Pharisees and Herod. What are those two things? And in my study this week, when I was looking up what the theologians said, Jesus is talking about the yeast of the Pharisees is religion. The yeast of Herod is politics. Here's what Jesus said in the midst of everything going on. He said, he turns around and he looks at the guys and he says, listen, you need to beware of the yeast of the Pharisees and of Herod. You need to be careful about religion and politics and how it impacts you. Both of these things, I put in your notes, cause division and they distract us from the mission of the church. Think about it. Right now, in this room, in our church, and listen, who is Jesus talking to? Is Jesus talking to unbelievers? He's talking to the disciples. Thank you. He's talking to the disciples. He said, guys, y'all need to be careful about religion and politics distracting you from the mission of the church. That hit me really hard because I have very strong political opinions. I have very strong religious opinions. And I want you to think right now about what Jesus is warning you and I. You need to be careful and not get off on a ditch with religion and get off on a ditch with politics, because if you're not careful, it's going to mess you up. We need to be mindful of the mission of the church. We need to remember, if Jesus comes back tomorrow, he's not going to ask to see your voter ID card. Oh, come on, somebody. But he is going to look at your heart. He's not going to wonder whether we did church inside, outside, parking lot, mask on, mask off. Those things are not that important. But he is going to ask about your relationship with him. That's what he cares about. And like I said, I have incredibly strong political and religious opinions, but I cannot allow those things to impact my relationship with God and the mission of the church. Because our mission is to reach the lost and to disciple people. And guys, I'm telling you, as a church body, as a family here and online, we have to remember that. We are on mission. The last 2 weeks have reminded me that I was taken out. I had 102.9 fever. Got right up there with my IQ, doc. It was a tough few days. And I couldn't do anything. And I'm not used to that. And I'm thinking, what's going on here? Is the mission going on? How are we doing things? Praise God, we've got an awesome team and we're moving forward. But we have to remember, life is happening, but the mission moves forward, regardless of who's in the White House or the outhouse. Oh, that's good. Right? We've got to remember that. And we've got to stay on mission. Because we are Christ followers. We are Christ followers. Amen? And I'm talking today about Christians being divided and distracted. So how do we navigate this season? Well, we got to get a handle on it. And today I want to help you get a handle on it. In my Jeep, on the passenger side, there is a handle. Why is there a handle in a Jeep? Come on, somebody. Because it's liable to get wonky sometimes. Right? And it's amazing to me, in Doc's boat, there's a handle, because if you ever ridden with Doc, you need a handle, right? Come on, you got to have a handle. Got to have a handle. Because what happens, sometimes stuff goes on, and when things start a-rocking, you want to grab something that you can hold on to stabilize you. It anchors you. And right now, you and I need to figure out what our handles are. Because things are rocking, and here's what happens. If right now a little earthquake started happening, I'd be reaching out, grabbing something that I can hold on to that would stabilize me, that would anchor me. We have to get a handle on things. So here's my question for you today. What is your handle? What are you grabbing a hold of right now? What is it when the newscast comes in and it bothers you? What do you grab? What do you immediately reach out and grab? Amen. But do we all do that? We need to have a handle on things. Look at Mark chapter 8, verses 17 through 19. Aware of their discussion, Jesus asked them, "Why are you talking about having no bread? Do you still not see or understand? Are your hearts hardened? Do you have eyes but fail to see? Do you have ears but you're not hearing?" And then he says these words, "And don't you," everybody say it with me, "remember." When I read this week, it hit me right in the gut. Jesus is saying, when things start rocking, what are you holding on to? Do you remember what I have done? Do you remember? This is one of those messages today, when I get to the end, you'll get it. Each one of you has to look in your life and decide, what am I holding on to? What am I grasping during this season of instability? What is the Lord teaching me? And I want you to understand today how quickly we forget things that we previously held on to. Things that we should remember, we tend to forget. Jesus reminds the guys of two great miracles, feeding the 5,000 and feeding the 4,000. And he reminds us that if God could do this twice, why can't he handle the situation where you've only got one loaf of bread right now? Think about it. They've just walked out of Jesus feeding 4,000 people. They get in the boat. They get offshore. They want a sandwich. They turn around and they go, "Peter forgot the sandwiches again. What have we got? We got a loaf of bread." And Jesus is like, "I just fed 10,000 people with 7 loaves. I got this." Do you not remember? Gut punch. Gut punch. And yet he's talking to them and they're like, "Jesus, we have no idea what you're talking about." And he begins to explain, "Do you not remember?" Here's a big thought, guys. If God did something miraculous once, he has the power to do it again. If God has done a miracle once, he has the power to do it again. That's the reason I wanted Wes to play that song today. "I've seen you move. I've seen you move the mountains. And I believe that I will see you do it again. I believe it. And I've seen God do miracles, then why do I doubt now? Why do I somehow feel that in the midst of this situation, God can handle everything else, but I don't know about this? I don't know about this." What's your handle? What are you holding on to? Do you remember what he has done? If God did something miraculous once, he has the power to do it again. And that is exactly what Jesus is saying to the disciples. Do you not? He says, "Look, how many bread baskets did we get when we did the 5,000? 12 bread baskets. Okay, how many did we do for 7? And then Jesus is going, "Do you get it? If we did that, we can handle this." And folks, that needs to be the stance that you individually take right now. If God could do all these things over these years, the coronavirus is not freaking him out. Amen. Same miracle working God. Same Jesus on the cross. Same Jesus that rose again, that's now looking at you and I. And he's saying to us, "Do you not remember?" Remember, Chris. I can promise you, there were 3 days during coronavirus. If Ronnie would have just come over, dug a hole, and said, "Walk in here, I'm covering you up," I'd have been like, "You're going to have to pick me up and throw me in, but I'm okay with that." Because it was not fun. I walked into the ER the other day, walked in, looked at the nurse. She goes, "You want to sit down?" I said, "No, I want to lay down." And she goes, "Well, no wonder you got 102.9 fever." And I just looked at her and I said, "Do something." Because I felt bad. Just felt bad. They gave me a shot. Any of you that know me know that's my kryptonite. okay? You can just show a shot and I'd be like, right? Okay? I didn't care. She said, I'm going to give you an IV. I said, I don't care. IV, do something. But I remember very vividly praying, and this is what I prayed. Here's what I said, God, do something. And he began to remind me, I already have. I already have. Do you not remember? And just like David, and just like the other people in the Bible that look back and they've seen God do miracles, and David would say, I killed a lion and I killed a bear. I can deal with Goliath. He remembered what God had done. And in this season right now, and I'm going to jump ahead, it's at the bottom of your notes. I gave you some questions that you need to ask yourself. Think about when you've seen God do a miracle in your life. The job that you needed, he provided for. A child being sick that God did a miracle. Sometime in your life when you have seen God do this, something that, and if he can do that, Jesus said, remember, he can do this. Because he is a miracle-working God. And he has not changed. But I want to say this to you today. He needs you to participate. You get to choose. God, help me decide. Lord, help me to choose to remember. And one of the ways you're going to remember is by writing things down. And that's why I gave you these notes today. I've given you homework. You need to go home, Christy, and think about, when have I seen God do something cool? And you begin to write those things down. Here's what will happen, Carol. You'll begin to encourage yourself. Well, if God did that and he did that, then I reckon he can handle this. And then my faith begins to rise. But if all you do is focus on what's going to happen with school and what's going to happen with this and all I've got is a loaf of bread and what are we going to do, you're focusing on the wrong thing. You're focusing on trouble, not on God. Amen? Man, I'm preaching better than you are, amen. And come on, I've been waiting 3 weeks for this, somebody. Come on. I'm giving you everything I got, right? So number one, what is your handle? What are you holding on to? Number two, this one really impacted me. You need a handle to help reach other people. You need a handle to help reach other people. What does that mean? You are only as strong as what you are holding on to. You are only as strong, Mark, as what you're holding on to. And I had this illustration, y'all know how I think. In my mind, I was thinking about two guys in a pool with a rope in between them playing tug of war. And they're in the pool, so they're buoyant. They're not tied off on anything. So what's going to happen? Well, they're just going to pull each other around the pool. Why? Because they don't have anything to hold on to. They're not anchored to anything. Which means they're not going to go anywhere and they're not going to accomplish anything. For us, we need handles so that when things begin to go on, I can reach over here and I can grab this handle and now I can reach out and help you. But if I don't have a hold to something, I can't help you. So I need a handle not only to stabilize myself, I need a handle so that I can help Spencer. And guess what happens? When I've got a handle and now I've got a hold of Spencer, then Spencer can reach out and help somebody too. But I can't help somebody if I'm not anchored solidly, Keith. I can't do it. You are only as secure, I put in your notes, as your handle. What is your handle? What is your handle? And I wrote this down because I'm a smart aleck. You ready? You can't help anyone if you don't have a grip. Oh. You gotta have a grip. As we move into the fall, in these next few weeks are pivotal. Donald, as we do this, this is pivotal. As we move into the unknown, we need to trust and hold on to the known. We need to recognize, Andrew, who we've got a hold of, and realize that he will not move. This is what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, verses 31 through 33. Do not worry. Everybody say, do not worry. Come on, Dennis. This is what we've been talking about. Do not worry. What shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or as my daughter would say, what shall I wear? And if y'all tell her I said she's a pagan, I will deny it. For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. And look at what Jesus says. Here's a handle for you right now. You ready? You ready, Bree? Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, which is His way of doing things. And all these things will be given to you. Get your handle right. Get your handle right. And God says, I'm going to help you. But you got to look at what you're holding on to. You and I need to get a handle on this. And Jesus is our handle. Jesus is our anchor. Jesus is our foundation. Jesus is our source. Jesus is our shield. Jesus is our strength. And Jesus is our peace. So I want to leave you with a quote today by Corrie Ten Boom. And this is what Corrie said. Worry does not empty tomorrow of its troubles, but it empties today of its strength. Worry does not empty tomorrow of its troubles, but it empties today of its strength. On your talk about it, on your notes today, your homework is this that I want you to take home. Here are these things. These are very simple. Think about a time that God did something miraculous in your life. What was it? Write that down. What is the difference between that time and now? What's the difference between that time and now? And then the last question is, what would keep God from doing something amazing now? What is it? You know what my Bible says? Nothing can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. Neither death, famine, hell, angels, demons, nothing can keep God from doing what He wants to do in my life and in your life. And child of God, our community is scared. There are people in our church online that are scared. And now is the time that we trust our God and remember what He has done and provide a handle for those around us that need Him. Amen? That's what we're going to do. Over these next few weeks, we're going to be talking to you about what the fall looks like for the church. We're going to do the very best we can to help you to continue to grow in your relationship with Him. And I want to know, more as well as anybody here, if you aren't feeling well, you can stay home and watch online, and we're going to continue to improve that. We're going to make sure as a church that we provide resources for you guys to continue to grow. But remember why you grow. One of the things is so that you can stand yourself. But the other part is so you can reach out to somebody else. Because they're going to need you. They need the Jesus inside of you. Amen? Amen. Wes, do you have anything you're going to play? Okay. I want to pray for you today. And I want you to think about this. Worry does not empty of us of tomorrow's troubles. Jesus said this. Why are you worrying about tomorrow? Focus on today. Guys, you need to make a quality decision that you're going to trust God's word. And you need to do this. You need to sit down and you need to write out some things that you've seen God do. And you need to remind yourself of those things. I can promise you the last couple weeks for me, I was thinking about things that I've seen God do because that was helping me get through this. You need to remember. like Jesus said, remember. And then watch what he does. This is the most loving church I've ever been around in my life. Over the last years, whenever I've asked somebody that wanted to join our church, and I said, what do you think about our church, Gayla? What is it? They said, it's the most loving group of people. Y'all just love each other and hug on each other. For us to not be able to do that right now is hard. It's hard for me. Because some of you need a hug. Right? But we're having to do things different to protect you. But there is no difference and distance in prayer. Jesus is right here with us, walking through this season with us. This will end. This season will pass. What are you learning in this season? What are you learning in this season? Let's all stand this morning. I almost want to say grab hands, but I can't, right? You can grab your people next to you's hands. You are blessed. You are the people of God. The power of the Holy Spirit is in you. The strength that you need to overcome the challenges that we are facing is within you, and it is available to you. Hold on to the cross. Hold on to the Savior. Allow His strength to fill you and become the people of God that your family needs, that your students need, that your patients need, that your co-workers need, that your employees need, that your customers need. Become those people and allow God to do something amazing during this season. Amen. Father, I thank you for these people today. Lord, I thank you for your love that is over us. I thank you for your Holy Spirit that's available to us. And Father, I pray in Jesus' name that your power would be in them and fill them. Lord, that you would overcome their fears. That as we cast all of our fears on you, you care for us. Lord, help us to have a handle on this, to hold on to you, so that we can reach out to others. And we thank you for this, Lord, in the precious and amazing and holy name of Jesus. And all of God's amazing people gave a big amen. So be it. God bless you guys. We'll see you online, and we'll see you next week. Y'all have a great week. Love you much. Air hugs. Air hugs.